Thanks a lot, Vivek. So I arrived yesterday night very late, so perhaps I'm not still very awake. So I try to please apologize. I'd like to apologize because I'm not completely ready. But okay, so today it will be a kind of introduction of my series of lecture. So I will give the main motivation of my work. So it will be about simulation sampling. So perhaps it will be a nice introduction to the topic that will be covered, for example, by Peter Glean next week. So it will be an introduction to this. So then I will give a crash course on metropolis sampling algorithms. So perhaps it's nothing very new, nothing very fancy there. So it's very, very old stuff. But just to set up the landscape. And then I will just introduce the Langevin diffusion and some algorithm which has been derived from Langevin diffusion and the stochastic gradient Langevin. So okay, so today it will be more like about motivation, introductions, and things which are perhaps for most of you quite obvious, but just to set up the scene. Okay, so what are the motivations? So the motivation for this work comes from mainly as I said, machine learning in general, so signal processing, image processing, things like this. And the problem I am willing to address today is about sampling, but in very large dimensional space. Say, so typically, there are a lot of applications of sampling in high dimensional space. So with there are many, many applications. I will not go far in application because I know that you are more probabilist than statistician or anything else. But so there are many applications. So you have also Bayesian inference for high dimensional models. So this will be the example I will more or less consider as a vehicle to illustrate what I'm doing. But there are other applications. I will not really spend time on them, but which are, of course, of interest, which are basically Bayesian regularization for inverse problems, and I worked on several applications with colleagues on image restoration and blurring, and in particular, when you do inverse problem, it becomes an issue to be able to quantify the error in the reconstruction of the object that you are the reconstruction of the problem. So there are also applications to something which is more which has more machine learning flavor, which is aggregation of estimator and experts. And I will not speak about that, but it was really the main motive. When I started to work on high-dimensional sampling, say 10 years ago, that was really one of the first motivation I had in mind, how to do aggregation for of estimators. And there is another kind of problems which are closely related to high-dimensional sampling is Bayesian non-parametrics, which is more or less what you are trying to do is to sample, but in functional space. So what is called Bayesian non-parametrics, it means like it's like non-parametric statistics. So basically, you are trying to estimate objects which belong to function space. So it's like it's not high dimension; it's in that case infinite dimension. But of course, because you are running that on computer, and finite dimension become finite because more or less you are projecting it to sieves or something like this, and you end up by solving problems in high dimension. And so what was the motivation of my work is that most of the sampling techniques known so far do not scale very well in high dimension. So there are some caveats. This sentence is not completely true because of course there are very successful application of Monte Carlo in high dimension, and for example, in computational physics, so you when you do molecular dynamics, for example, you are sampling a super large dimension space, and it works. But there are reasons for which it works because there are some kind of it's a very regular potential if you wish. So in general, for the problems that we are tackling, so which have not such a nice structure, some problem in physics have, something in high dimension is a problem. And also there is another issue now is that when you are doing statistics now, you are two dimension which becomes large. So both you use models which have a very large number of parameters. So I will give an example then. And also, you have a very large number of data. So you have a large number of observations. So there are two, these two dimensions will come into play. So which means that there are a lot of challenges. If you go to a machine learning conference, there is even now some workshop which is called Bayesian deep learning, so where they are trying to do things on Bayesian approaches for super large dimensional machine learning problems. Okay, so that was my motivation. So I just give you a very basic example. It's not the only example I have in mind, but it's an example on which I will do my illustration. So I will spend some time to explain it, and it gives an idea of what we are doing. So it's a very classical problem in statistics, but you are mostly probabilists and not statisticians, so I will explain. So basically, it's a problem of a logistic regression. So in logistic regression, what you are trying to do is the following thing. So you have a set of parameters. You have a set of responses, yi, which are binary responsive. It's 0 and 1. And you are trying to have also a set of covariates, xi, so which are d-dimensional, and the dimension d can be very large. And what you are trying to guess is whether the answer will be 1 or 0. And the model that you use is that the answer yi, so the binary answer, are equal to 0 or 1 according to the following model. So the model is the following. It says that the random variable yi are Bernoulli random variable, and this Bernoulli random variable have a certain success probability. And the success probability is a function, of course, taking value in 0, 1, of a linear combination of the covariates. This is the most simple example, of course, of you can do things which are much more complicated than that. But this is a very, very simple example and very popular example in machine learning, at least in elementary application of machine learning, where you try to predict, for example, whether someone will develop an cancer or not. So you are developing, yes, it's 1, you are not developing, it's 0. And then you have a lot of covariates, which can be, for example, genomes data or phenotypic data and things like this. And you try to say, okay, what you try to predict whether you will develop some kind of illness or not. So that's a typical example. There are two special examples which I will mention most of the time, which is probit regression, in which, in this case, F is a standard normal cumulative distribution, or logistic regression, in which case F is a standard logistic cumulative distribution. Okay? And so what are the difficulties of the problem then? Okay. So that worked very well. So what are the difficulties of the problem? So typically when you set up a Bayesian problem, what you will typically do is that you will put a prior distribution on the parameter. So we not discuss that, but it's so imagine, for example, that we say that your prior distribution on the model can be pi of beta, which is some either Gaussian distribution, or it can be a Laplace distribution, for example. There are many much more. They are not necessarily very good prior, by the way. And so in large dimensions, so there are, it's not. If you try to look at a Bayesian analysis, it's not necessarily good prior. So but I will not discuss these points. Typically, in large dimension, people use different type of priors, like Ostrow priors, for example. In large dimension, but it's not a problem for what I will explain then. So you take a prior, and what is a graal in Bayesian analysis is to go from prior to posterior. So what is a posterior is the posterior distribution is simply equal to the distribution of the parameter beta, this time given the observations. So which means given the observation, so you have two terms. So you have the likelihood of the observation, which is given by this term. So it's the likelihood of Bernoulli random variables, so which can be written there. N is the number of individuals that you have in your study. And pi beta is a posterior. And the problem I have in mind, so it's the problem that we try to address, is the problem of sampling. So what you are doing to do is that you are willing to sample this distribution. you are willing to do, for example, you are willing to estimate moments of this distribution for a given variable. You are willing to estimate credible intervals or credible sets for the parameters. And for doing this, typically you need to access to this distribution, which is very complex, by the way, because it's very complex because it's a product of something which is typically not so complex, which is a prior distribution multiplied by something which puts a lot of constraints among the parameter beta. So which is a likelihood of the observation. And remember that in many applications, both beta, so the dimension D is very large, and also the number of samples is very large. So it's a very difficult problem, by the way. Okay, so to give some ideas, so in many problems I have addressed, so the number of parameters is large, so it can be 10 to the power 4, but it can be larger than that. With John Drew, for example, from Stanford, exactly on this type of problem, and with different type of priors, which are going to D, which are dimension 10 to the power 6, okay? And the number of observation is also typically very large. It can be 10 to the power 5 or 6 or things like that. So there are many, many applications. So text categorization, matrix factorization, binary matrix factorization, which you have to adapt a little bit the framework, gene expression analysis, and many other data mining tasks. So it's a very important problem, which is not so easy to solve. Okay, so then, so what are the objective of what? So it's a problem. So if you don't want to sample this, but if you are willing to do maximum but a posterior estimation, if you are willing to maximize a posterior distribution, which is a regularized likelihood problem. That's especially for this type of stuff, it's a very easy problem. So it's considered as, now it's very straightforward. So it's, so you have a lot of good algorithm for doing this. And you have also convergence guarantee, both in the dimension and in the sample size. So we'll not discuss that, but it means that you have a full set of results. Linked with this type of stuff, and there is so a huge gap between what we know in optimization and what we know in terms of simulation. And what are the long-term objectives that I will try to fill during the three courses is to try to fill the gap between optimization and simulation. In particular, it would be interesting to develop algorithm which can be shown. Probably to convert to the target distribution with mixing time, which are, say, polynomial in the dimension. So, of course, because if you are, so it's important for the user to know, even if it's, of course, a bit difficult to imagine that we'll have precise enough result for the mixing time. In order to be able to say, okay, I will have to stop my algorithm after, say, 200 steps. I think it's not possible, but it will be good to know, for example, whether the mixing time of this algorithm depends, say, exponentially on the dimensions. It would be very bad in that case, or only polynomially, and perhaps even sub. So in some case, you can prove things which is even sub-polynomially, okay?
When you have a high-dimensional problem, low-dimensional approximations. Are
these
simulation algorithms which
explore? Yeah, that's a very good question. And the answer is we try to, so prior try, so of course, so it's a very good question. It's more linked with the type of priors that you are using. So just I will answer this question, I will not spend too much time on that, but if you use these priors, so basically, if you want to promote sparsity in the solution, of course, when you do optimization, you will use this prior. Because it will be, it's a L1 prior and it's a lasso, so there's a lot of theory about that. But in fact, this prior does not, it doesn't mean that this distribution will be sparse. So the maximum is sparse, the solution, but the distribution does not promote sparsity. If you want to promote sparsity in the posterior distribution, you have to use other type of priors.
Okay.
okay, which are called horseshoe priors. So there are a lot of priors. So priors which have a lot of mass at zero and a lot of mass for very large value. So this type of prior, in fact, it's funny because it does not promote. So when you compute the map, the maximum a posteriori, the map would be sparse. But when you sample from this distribution, typically it will not be sparse. Okay. So this is why you typically do not use this type of stuff. But of course, one way when going to high dimension is to try to identify which components are almost zero, and then you can more or less shrink. So I will not discuss that because it's another dimension, but it's of course very important. No, this one is not very good neither. It's a different type of priors that you should use. If you want to promote past sparsity, you have to use different type of priors, which are well known in this type of problems. The type of priors that you should use are well known. They're called horseshoe. So because they have a kind of very specific, they are called horseshoe because they have a lot of mass at zero. It's something like that. So it's something like this. It's also something like this because it means that you have a lot of mass at zero, okay, and then you have a lot of mass for because it means that what you are trying to promote is the fact that it's either almost zero or it's either you don't want to penalize when it's very very large, okay, and you can prove things like it has been done by. Van der Waart, Gosel, and so there are a lot of works on Bayesian parametrics and sparse estimation and things like this in Bayesian stuff. And it's these priors are more or less they will not necessarily comply so with what I will explain later because they are not convex and things like that. Okay, so let's continue. I will and then I will give for say 20 minutes. Just a crash course on Metropolis Hastings. So who is knowing Metropolis Hastings already? Everybody. So who is not knowing Metropolis Hastings? Okay, one to answer. So who doesn't know the word Metropolis Hastings? Okay. Okay. So it's so I will explain that because it will be part of my it's an important component of what I will say. And Metropolis Hastings techniques are, I will make some deviation around this scheme, but it's really the scheme that you have to know when you want to sample distribution. So it's a way, it's one of the oldest algorithms known in, it's one of the first algorithms which has been implemented on the computer, by the way, because it has been invented by people working in neutronics at the end of the 40s. So it's in the paper by Metropolis, not with Hastings. Hastings is a later addition, but Metropolis and Rosenblut paper was published in 51. So it's more or less one of the first algorithms which has been implemented on ENIAC computer. So it's a very old idea, but it's a very successful one. Okay. So idea is the following. So imagine that you are willing to sample a distribution pi. Okay, but what you will see, so in high dimension, of course, it's a bit hopeless to sample directly from pi. So what you will do is something a bit different, in the sense that you will build a Markov kernel. So you will build a Markov chain, okay, which is reversible, and I will explain what reversible means later on with respect to pi. And of course, because it will be reversible with respect to pi, you will have pi as its stationary distribution. So I will explain the way you proceed, and I will explain all these words. So the assumption to make things simple is that I will assume that pi has a density with respect to some sigma finite measure. So it's not, typically it will be RD and nu will be the Lebesgue measure, but it's not essential there. And I will denote h pi the density, and I will also assume to avoid problems that the density is everywhere positive. Okay, so sometimes I will use pi for the density, so sometimes I will mix a bit the notations. Okay, so what I will do typically is that I will find a transition kernel. I will explain what is a transition kernel then, but it's simply a kernel. What is a transition kernel? What is a transition density? A transition density is a function of x and y, okay, and which is such that q, x, and y are measurable, and for all x in Rd, q, x, y is a probability density function. So basically, it means what? It means that what is a transition density? It's a proposal mechanism. So I will explain that in the next slide. So the algorithm works like this. So you construct the Markov chain according to that. So you at a given steps, you are given xk, so which is the current state, is the current value of the Markov chain. So it's xk, and what you will do is that you will propose a candidate. So you propose a candidate. You propose a candidate according to this transition probability, uxk, y. So you draw a candidate according to this density. Okay, so fine, but of course, if you simply do that, it will not be pi will not be the right stationary distribution. So it will not even be necessarily ergodic. So what you will do is that you will accept or reject. So you will either accept the draw or you will reject the draw. So the mechanism is very simple. So you will accept the draw with a given probability, which is alpha xk yk plus one. And if you don't accept this draw, you will stay at the current point with the probability which is given by this one. Okay? And then you have several possible expressions for the density. But for the most popular one is the one which has been raised by Hastings. There are other rules, Barker's rule, but the one which is used most of the time is the acceptance probability which has been developed by Hastings. So later, so it will be in the 70s. Metropolis has more or less the same solution, but less general one. And this acceptance rejection ratio is given by this quantity. So it's what you compute is h pi. So h pi is the density of the stationary distribution times q x y. Okay, and you divide. It's divided by h pi y q y x. Okay. So you compute this quantity given y k plus one, and then you draw a Bernoulli random variable with alpha x k y k plus one. As success probability, and you will then accept or reject the move. Okay, so it's a very simple it's very simple. And what you can prove is that this Markov chain is reversible. So it's more or less an easy exercise. So what reversibility means? So your next previous talk, you also what reversibility. So reversibility is a very simple property. So if P is a Markov kernel and Xi is a probability, we see that Xi is reversible with respect to the Markov kernel pi if basically the joint distribution of the two first terms, so Xi tensor product with pi, which is a joint distribution of say x0 and x1, is the same as the distribution of x1 and x0. So it's explained there. Okay, so you can reverse the course of the time. Okay, so that's the definition of reversibility. So it means something which is a bit more intuitive to get. So which means that for all bounded functions, you have this, okay? So, which means, so it's even have a very nice interpretation, by the way. If you write this, so it's xi dx, it will be p of x dx prime. And if you take two functions, so say we take two functions f and g, so it's fx gx prime. So this will be what? So imagine that f and g are positive in order to avoid any problems. So it would be the integral of psi dx. Okay, then you have f of x there. So it would be now the integral with respect to the state space x. So it would be px dx prime times g of x prime. So I will call this quantity p gx, so you apply the Markov kernel p to the function g at the point x, And so it will be the integral of psi dx fx times pgx. And this is simply equal to the scalar product, if you wish, of f and the function pg in, say, L2 of psi. Okay? And what does reversibility mean? It means that, basically, when the Markov kernel is reversible, it means that you have P, this is equal to Pf g, which means that, more or less, reversibility means that P is self-adjoint in L2 psi. Okay, so it's another way to saying that. It's not exactly, you have to be a little bit more careful. But, and of course, because reversibility means self-adjointness, and you have a lot of self-adjoint operators are much well behaved than other type of operators, so you have a spectral theory and things like that. So you can do, there are a lot of things which come from this type of stuff. There are very precise results which can be obtained. So the results that you can obtain for mixing time in Markov kernels are much more precise in general when you are reversible than when you are not reversible. We know much more on reversible Markov kernels in general than on non-reversible Markov kernels. And for when X is a countable space, so typically this condition is often referred to as what is called the detailed balance condition, which is intuitive in the sense that it means that the flow according, so if you have a psi of X, which is a distribution on X, okay, psi X P X X prime is the flow of mass going from X under psi to X prime in one step. Okay, and when it is detailed balance, it means that the flow of mass going from X to X prime in one step is the same as the flow of mass going from X prime to X, which is why it's called a detailed balance. Okay, so reversibility, self-adjointness, and detailed balance are very clear. And another trivial, I will give you the slide, hein, so another trivial result, when it's simply you rewrite things, is that a joint distribution, if xk is a Markov chain with Markov kernel p and initial distribution psi, if psi is reversible with respect to pi, to p, then it means that the joint distribution of x0 and x1 are the same as the distribution of x1 and x0. Okay, so which means that, in particular, it means that the distribution of x1 is the same as x0, which means that psi is p invariant. So which means that if a Markov kernel p is reversible, if psi is reversible with respect to p, in particular, psi is p invariant. And you can also, of course, that it's true for all n, which is it's also very simple to establish. Okay, so. No, of course, it's very special. Xi, so in general, you have a single stationary distribution. So the Markov kernel is simply reversible with respect to one distribution. Okay. And if a Markov kernel P is reversible with respect to the distribution Xi, if Xi is reversible with respect to P, Xi is a stationary distribution to P. And more or less, it would be the only one if P is irreducible. So which means there are not many distributions which are reversible with respect to pi. You are reversible with respect to a given distribution. And distribution is necessarily the stationary distribution of P. Okay, so that's a theorem which recaps everything. So if Xi is reducible to respect to P, two properties, Xi is P invariant, and you have the chain is reversible. This is why the term is reversible. It means that all the finite dimensional distribution of the Markov chain are reversible with respect to X, so which means the joint distribution of X0 and Xn for a Markov kernel, for a Markov chain with Markov kernel P and an initial distribution Xi is the same as the distribution of Xn, X0. Okay, so what we need to prove now, to prove that we have, it's a right algorithm, we need to prove that the reversibility of the Metropolis Hastings kernel. So you simply write the Metropolis Hastings kernel, so it's written like that. Okay, so it's easy to interpret. So it's So what the transition probability of the transition of Markov kernel P is you look at when you define what is the Markov kernel. So it's more or less the probability when you are at X, what is the probability to going to the set A? Okay, so it's PXA. So if you look at the Metropolis Hastings algorithms, there are two possibilities. So either you stay at the point X. Okay, so you stay at X, you don't move, so you stay at X, so which means that you have a component there, so which is the Dirac mass at the point X, okay? And what is the probability of staying at X? The probability of staying at X is the probability you stay at X if you have rejected the move, okay? So you reject the move according to this probability, so you reject the move with probability 1 minus alpha XY, and then you have to integrate this move with respect to the transition QXY and nu dy, which is a dominating measure. So, okay, that's the alpha bar X is the probability of staying at point X, okay? And there is a second component in this Markov transition, which is the probability, what is the probability of moving, of not staying at X, but the probability of not staying at X and going to A, by the probability of going from X to A, which is given by this transition density, okay, and then accepting the move, and you accept the move with probability alpha x1. Okay, so the transition kernel can be written like that. And what we will show is that the distribution pi, so in fact the acceptance ratio alpha xy is tailored in such a way that pi, which is a target distribution that you are trying to sample, is reversible with respect to the Metropolis Hastings kernel P. So that's exactly what you want to do, and to see that it's not very difficult. It's you start with a distribution. You start with the acceptance ratio. So you start with what is alpha xy. So alpha xy, you say it's 1. So it will be the density HPY QYX divided by HPX QXY. Okay, if you multiply this, so if you look at what is HPX alpha XY QXY, okay, so you multiply this by this denominator, so it will be the same thing that h pi x q x y time the minimum of h p y y q y x, and you see that this expression is completely symmetric in x and y, okay? And because this expression is symmetric in x and y, it would be exactly equal to h p a y alpha y x q y x. Okay, which is what I have written there, okay? So which means that when you look at the first term, you look at the first term, so you integrate with respect to psi dx, so psi dx is the density h pi x u dx, okay? So h pi x, so alpha xy q xy, you integrate 1 c xy, you just revert this like that, okay? So which means that the proposal is accepting with this probability. You have, it's easy to see that the second term satisfies the same property, and when you sum the two terms, you obtain this relation, which shows that pi is reversible with respect to p. So it means that it's a very, and it's a brilliant idea, it's a very simple idea, it's a brilliant idea. So it means that whereas in general, it's very difficult when you start with a Markov chain. If I give you a Markov kernel, it will be in general very difficult to know what is a stationary distribution. Okay, so it's a tough problem in general. Even knowing that it has a stationary distribution is difficult. But there is a very simple mechanism. When I give you any density distribution, any distribution pi having a density, you can generalize that a little bit, but it's basically, so if I give you a density, then it's very easy to compute, to define a Markov kernel which has the correct target distribution. Okay, so which is given by that. So there is an algorithm. So the first algorithm, which in fact, which is a very simple one. So which was the one proposed by Metropolis, so in his paper 51. And the proposal mechanism in that case was simply a random walk. So what you do typically, you are at point X, okay, and you just propose according, so you draw a random variable ZK plus one, independent from XK, so you just move according to some distribution. I know this distribution will have a density, say Q tilde. So you simply draw, you are at XK, you move locally, and you, by some point, ZK plus one, so you draw ZK plus one, and you just propose YK plus one. So which means that the proposal distribution, the density of the proposal, the transition density in that case is equal to Q tilde Y minus X, because it's the same thing as a random walk. And once you have done that, you have to accept and reject. So basically, because you have assumed, so in this special case, so you have, in this special case, you have the proposal density QXY is equal to Q tilde Y minus X. Okay, so QYX in that case is simply equal to Q tilde of X minus Y. And if you assume that Q tilde Z is equal to Q tilde minus Z, so you simply assume that it is the density is symmetric with respect to zero. So which means that you have in that case, you have QXY which is equal to QYX. Okay, and QXY equal to QYX means that when you look at the acceptance ratio will simplify that PY by X, and then you have QYX divided by QXY, but these two quantities are equal, so you simply look at this, and it becomes very simple, in the sense that what you do is that you start at XK, okay, you just make a local move, okay, according to this random walk, and you will do two things. So either, so it will be H pi, yeah? So it's, I should have an H pi there, so it's a density. So either you land up in a point where the density has a larger value, then you will always accept the move, okay? You accept the move when you climb, okay? So you get a value which is larger, say if H pi y is larger than H pi x, then of course you will accept the move, or if h pi y is lower than h pi x, what you will do is you will reject the move with a certain probability. Okay, so that's a very, very simple. And that was the algorithm proposed by Metropolis. It's called sometimes the Metropolis algorithm, and which has been proposed in, as I said, one of the first Monte Carlo algorithms which has been proposed. So you can prove a lot of things for the Metropolis Hastings algorithms. So you can prove... So you have very, very, you have a very general result which can be proven. So you can prove with very, very simple assumptions. So if the density is positive, if the transition density are positive, then the Markov kernel P is irreducible. So you have to be a little bit careful because it's we are speaking about Markov chain in continuous state space. So irreducibility is something a little bit different from irreducibility of Markov chain in discrete state space, okay, but I will not spend too much time on that. So typically, if you assume that these two quantities are positive, then you can prove that the Markov kernel is irreducible, so it's and therefore that it admits a unique invariant distribution, which is, of course, pi. Without any assumption also, you can prove that the Markov kernel is ergodic, okay, and without any other assumption that the fact that f is in L2 pi, you can prove a central limit theorem. So with very weak additional assumption. So which means that, and this is a very nice result, which is linked to the reversibility. So with reversibility, when you have a reversible Markov chain, typically assume that you are in L2 pi, then you will have a central limit theorem. It's with very few additional conditions. But, okay, so it's that very promising. It is what was known, basically, at the beginning of the, say, at the end of, say, end of the 60s or beginning of the 70s. And then people start to ask, okay, but that's very nice, but it's very asymptotic. So it's, Okay, it's true that it's ergodic, so it means if I run this Markov chain for a very long time, I will end up to have a reintegrated Markov pipes. It's fine, but I don't know how fast I convert to the Chatterley distribution, or it's the same for this, so it's a centrally mixed theorem, but it's not clear how much sample I need to sample in order to that the centrally mixed theorem start to kick in. Okay. So this is why, in fact, we need, if you want to analyze algorithm like that, you need to be more precise, and you need to have an access to mixing time. So this is how you it's not enough to say, okay, it's ergodic, or you have a centrally mixed theorem, it's not enough. You need to have mixing time. So there are several ways to define mixing time. I will use at least two ways to define them, or three ways to define them. The first, I will look mainly mixing time in total variation, so there are many reasons for that. I will not explain why, but what is total variation? So there are other, you can define it with other distance, but I will use total variation as distance. So what is total variation? Total variation is defined as follows. So if you take any finite sign measure, okay, of course the finite sign measure has the Jordan decomposition, which is unique. So you can, there's a positive and a negative component, and the total variation is defined as the mass of the sigma plus sigma minus of x, okay? The total variation distance between two probability measures is defined as the total variation of the difference between the probability measure xi and xi prime, which is xi minus x prime, of course, is a finite sign measure, okay, and you can define it like that. So there is a 1/2 there, so it's not always a... If you look at the literature, there is a lot of different definition of total variation. So sometimes there is without 1/2, so I take 1/2, okay, so there are many good reasons for doing this, and bad reason also. Okay, so you have other characterization of total variation. So total variation is a supremum for, if you take functions which are bounded and measurable, of course, it's a supremum of psi of phi, so it can be seen as a... And there is a very important characterization, which is given by this one, which is, it's a semi-norm, in fact, of psi of f, for all functions which have oscillation which is less than one. And then you have a two kicking in here. Okay. Okay, so total variation is an important measure. So you can define more general measures. The more general measures are called V total variation. So instead of, so you put a weight. So instead of looking at functions which are bounded, this time you are looking at functions which are dominated by some function f, okay? So I assume that f is finite everywhere, so it's not necessarily needed, but you define the f norm like that, and you may define the f norm of a measure by this time, instead of computing the total variation of the set, the indicator of the set, you compute the integral of the function f with respect to the total variation measure, okay? So that's psi of f, and then you may define in exactly the same way, you obtain the same characterization. This is where, in fact, it's almost the same insect that you have lost the two for the oscillation there, so it's difficult to reconcile everything, but that's a characterization for f norm. Okay, so that's a two type of measure, and so what you are trying to, so what you are interested in, when if you are willing to be when you are willing to get a precise rate of convergence, the type of condition that you are willing to obtain is something like this. So given x, so you want to have a kernel P. Pn, of course, is the iterator of the kernel, and you will see that this kernel is f geometrically ergodic if it satisfies this inequality. So it means that the iterate Pn of x minus pi in f norm, okay, is bounded by a function m of x, which this function should be, of course, explicit, otherwise it's not very interesting, so it should be explicit, and with a sum rate, which is beta n of x, okay? Okay, so it gives you, so if you're able to say that you obtain a measurable function Of course, beta should be larger than one, at least with probability one. You will say that P is geometrically ergodic. Okay, instead of that, exactly the type of thing. So, in order to be able to measure how fast you are converging to pi, you typically need to get inequality like that. Okay. Okay. So, what are the standard tools to do that? The standard tools to do that are two things. Okay. So, in fact, there is a very general theory which has been started basically in discrete time. It is known since say basically the end of the 50s, and then people start to look at Markov chain in continuous time. So, Professor Atreya did a lot in the 70s in this area, works basically started with work by Auré and Atreya and then Numelin and so during the 60s and the 70s. And at the end of the 70s, we have more or less a general theory has been obtained, and which can be summarized as follows. So typically, you need to understand what is a drift condition. So what is a drift condition? It's simply you have to control the return time of functional to some sets. Okay, so a set C typically is said to be F delta geometrically recurrent if this quantity is finite. So what you do is for the following thing is that you look at the excursion between two. So sigma C is a return time to the set C. Okay, and you are looking at what? You are looking at the excursion of f of xk out, you start from C, you wait until you return to C. Okay? And you are summing delta k fxk along one excursion from C to C. And you will say that the set C is geometrically recurrent if, basically, this quantity is finite. So of course, if you take f equal 1, this is equivalent to say, if f is equal to 1, so if you are interested only in TV, it's simply equivalent to say that you have a geometric, so which means that you have a geometric moment, so return time as a geometric, is a finite geometric moment when you start uniformly in C. So whenever you start from C, whatever the starting point x is, then you have this moment is uniformly bounded. And there is a very, at least, it's a famous theorem. So it's a lot of application of this theorem. So a lot of theory around that. We say that the set C, the fact that C is F delta geometrically recurrent, is equivalent to have a drift condition. So drift condition has been developed. So it's linked, of course, a lot of Dirichlet problem and things like that, but I will not explain that here. But drift condition is written like that. So you have to find a function v, okay, which is positive, which satisfies this condition, okay. Okay, so it's equivalent. So the two quantities that in that case are equivalent. And the second property is to have a small set. So small set. So first, we need to, so well, we know now what is a drift condition. So the second type of property which are very important in the theory of continuous state space Markov chain are small sets. Or small sets are sets which satisfy this property. It's sets which satisfy that you have, if you take a certain iterate of the Markov kernel, so PMX, so whenever you are in X in C, the probability from going to X to A in M step is lower bounded by some quantity which is independent of X. So this is the thing which is important. So it's an M small set if this probability becomes independent from X in C. And there is a very, very beautiful, so what you can prove is that small set exists under very, very, for as soon as P is what is called phi irreducible, so it's a very general property. And once you have no small sets, in fact, there is the theory which has been developed, in particular by Professor Atreya, is to develop regeneration time. So what, I will not explain that now, but so what you will do is that as soon as you have a small set, you can build a Markov chain on an extended space. Okay, so you have to extend the Markov chain. But the extension is nice in, this, in such a way that you are able to predict from, you will work on this extension. The extension will be a Markov chain with an atom, so with a regeneration time, and you may obtain properties of the original Markov chain from the extended Markov chain. So there are, it's called the splitting construction, and the splitting construction is a very nice idea, which allow to do the theory of continuous state space Markov chain. Okay, and the main theorem, yep. So, for the time, it can be one, it can be 10, okay. Can be, of course, when it comes from the bound, it will come. Sorry? Oh, yeah, of course, yeah. It's the same, in fact, basically it's the same. Like PT, so it will be the same, yeah, it will be the same. Okay, so what you can prove is the following. So it's more or less the most general result that you can obtain. If you have this, so assume that V is finite, so because otherwise it's a bit more complicated. Assume that V is finite, so you remove this S, so provided that you have a small set, so an M small set, S, okay? And imagine that you have a drift condition to this small set. So drift condition to a small set means that the small set is F lambda minus 1 geometrically recurrent, okay? And C is a small set, okay? So if you have a small set which is F delta geometrically recurrent, then what you can prove is this bound. So you have an explicit bound, which is given by that. And of course, beta and kappa, they exist, but they can be computed. So there are many different ways to compute this. They are more or less ugly, but there is a way to compute this quantity. So which means that the theory of mixing time for Markov chain is easy in the sense that once you have the only thing that you have to do is that you have to identify a small set, and there are many small sets. And basically, if you are typically small sets are not exceptional. There are many small sets, and if you are able to compute drift condition to a small set, but then you obtain a bound. Of that sort. Okay, the problem is that this bound typically is very, very bad. So it means that beta are extremely close to one, okay, and that kappa is super large, but it's a way to obtain a bound. So it has been worked out, for example, for random Hamming metropolis. So it's one of the first algorithms, MCMC algorithm, which has been analyzed with this type of stuff. So RWM has been shown to be geometrically ergodic. So basically, the paper of Jerner and Hansen, they find a small set and they compute a drift condition. So there was a paper before that, but this paper is the first which compute constant kappa and beta. So for example, in all when you compute the constant, typically what you will prove, for example, in the example I've shown, that these constants are exponentially slow in the dimension. So if you run a random walk metropolis testing algorithm on the Bayesian analysis of a binary regression case, you will obtain it's one minus something which is exponential minus d. So when d is, so it's one minus two to the power minus 100, something like that. So which means that it's completely useless. So it's, in practice, it's useless. So it does not, so these type of techniques are very nice because they are very general, but they don't provide a direct mean to access to the true mixing time. Okay, So I will skip this part. So, okay, so I will not explain. I can stop here. Okay, and tomorrow I will resume at this point. What we are trying to do, and what I will explain in the next 2 hours, is that in some cases there is a much more direct method to get rate of convergence, to at least for certain class of algorithms, which allow to obtain much better result. In particular, what we are interested in, it's not completely quantitative, but it's more quantitative than that, in the sense that we'll be able to prove, for example, that in certain case we'll have a dependence in the dimension d, which will be a polynomial instead of being exponential. Okay, thanks for your attention, and tomorrow I will develop all this theory. Yeah, of course, of course. Yes, so people right now start to look at Wasserstein. So I will use a lot of Wasserstein. So I will connect Wasserstein with total variation tomorrow. But Wasserstein is sometimes easier. So some Wasserstein, not W2, but W1, or with some modification. No, it's of course the TV is very. It's a part of the problem that TV is very strong. It's a strong guarantee, okay? So Wasserstein is sometimes better. For example, and the analysis in Wasserstein, so for reasons which are not completely clear, people in MC, in Markovshein Monte Carlo method in MCMC, basically has been inspired a lot by the book by Meinen Twiddy, because Richard Twiddy was working with Gareth Roberts in the 90s, basically, so. So MCMC appears really in the literature in 85 to 90s, and Richard Twiddy met Gareth Roberts, and Gareth was a postdoc at that time, so now he's like me, so he was a postdoc at that time. So they advance, they make a lot of works on mixing time of MCMC, and using this type of method. So it was VNorm, TV, and things like that. So a lot of work in MCMC in the 90s and 2000 were around TV, okay? And there are good reasons also, sometimes it's a good reason to make TV. But actually people look at Wasserstein distance, for example, for example, when you analyze the Gibbs algorithm, Gibbs in Wasserstein are much easier to analyze in Wasserstein than in TV, and the results are much better. Okay, and sometimes you can reconnect Wasserstein to TV. So you can obtain, this is what we do tomorrow. So tomorrow I will mostly work with Wasserstein, and then I will add a kind of the end of the proof. I will add something in order to connect to TV, but without going to the regeneration technique. I think the regeneration technique, so my idea is that the regeneration technique is very nice in the sense that it gives you a kind of qualitative result linked with regeneration, but it's very difficult to get precise results with this type of method. So that's what I want to prove. But no, it's a good remark. Thanks.